Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Welcome, whether you're here with us in person, whether you're joining us online or by the telephone. It's wonderful to have you at worship with us this morning on this gloriously sunny but freezing cold morning. Now, this morning, Liz Patterson has come back. We couldn't have been that scary last time to play the piano for us. God's word is going to be brought to us by Sandra Black. We're all looking forward to that very much. Now, there are no fire drills planned, but in the event of the alarm, you absolutely know what's going to happen. I'm going to be waiting for you outside. Just leave quietly and tea and coffee as usual at the end of the service. Let's just take a few minutes to gather ourselves before we begin our worship. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for your welcome here to Claremont this morning. One or two of you vaguely recognise me and aren't quite sure why. That's because back in November, I facilitated your meeting with the other East Kilbride churches. And so some of you were there for that. And if your memory goes back quite a lot further, I was in East Kilbride South for a little while between 2013 and 15 as their interim minister. So I'm still an interim minister, but at the moment I'm working with Forth Valley and Clydesdale Presbytery just for a short while to add a little bit of extra support over the presbytery planning process. So that's why if you think, that woman looks vaguely familiar, but she was probably thinner the last time and younger the last time I saw her, then that's right, it's me. So I'm delighted to come and be part of your worship this morning. To focus our thoughts on our worship this morning, we have our call to worship, and I'm hoping the words are going to come up on the screen. Thank you very much, Lewis. They're from Psalm 130, and I invite you to join with me in saying these words from Psalm 130 as a focus to all our thinking today. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning. Put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. Let's sing to God's praise our first hymn, which is Speak, O Lord.
Thank you.
Now let's quieten our hearts and pray. Let us pray. Lord our God, we are glad to be here in your presence, glad for this time together, glad for this place, glad to be part of a company of your people, here to contemplate all your goodness, all your plans for us, glad to worship you, for you are God ever present, God who never gives up. Through all the generations, you have traveled with your people. You journeyed through the desert with the Israelites. Over the years, you listened to the complaints of your people, bore with their lack of belief, and through every difficulty, you did not give up. Then you sent Jesus and journeyed with him, and he journeyed with his disciples. And through the years of his ministry, through him, you spoke your word for us. And even in the times the disciples didn't understand, in those moments when they were foolish or full of their own importance, you did not give up. And when they were afraid and ran away, still you stuck with them. And through betrayal and denial, still you did not give up. And so we are thankful, Lord our God, that through the walk of our lives, you are a constant presence. If we complain, if we are afraid, if we are unfaithful, if we fail in our own eyes and let ourselves and others down, in all those places where we are less than the Christian people you call us to be, you stand by us. You offer us your forgiveness. You do not give up on us. You remind us and offer us day by day, moment by moment, your forgiving, renewing love, forgiveness for our sin, comfort for our sorrow, hope in our despair. And so we will walk with you and offer you our worship and commitment through Christ our Lord. So hear us as we pray together, as Jesus taught those who follow him, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, forever and forever. Amen.
Good morning. Would the little ones like to come forward a little, just to the front? Esther? Emmanuel? Good. Like to see pretty faces. Thank you, Rosie. Like to see pretty faces. No. Oh, they're fine. They're So, good morning. This morning I would like you to think about a story that, or a book that you liked when you were a child. Anyone have any offers? Anybody remember something that they particularly liked as a child to read?
Tarzan.
Millie Molly Mandy.
Oh yeah, Millie Molly Mandy, I remember that well. Peter Rabbit. Famous Five, who is that? Gordon. These are mine. The Bobbsey twins. Freddie and Flossie. I really would love to have had a twin. Alan's not too sure about that one. Two of me. The Famous Five. We all love to go to Demon's Rock or Kirin Island on an adventure. This was my favourite book ever that I read. And I know David Brown loved this one as well. The Silver Sword. About children being evacuated during the war, and it's a story of hope and courage. My favourite Bible story was always the loaves and fishes. I mean, it's all about sharing, and it's very important these days when some people have so much little compared to us. Our daughters loved The Tiger Who Came to Tea, and Rania Sophia loves it as well. As a children's librarian for many years, I told lots of stories and I wonder if the kids here know who this is. Who is it? Louder? The big hairy Gruffalo. Do you know this story? The story's about a little mouse who wanted to protect the animals and birds who had strayed into the forest from the Gruffalo. The little mouse wanted to protect them. And he wouldn't let the big Gruffalo bully the animals and the birds. He didn't do it by fighting. He did it by a caring heart and using his brain. If you've not read the story, you should read it. He was the tiniest of all the animals, but also the bravest. I think this story reminds us of how God wants to protect us, that we shouldn't stray too far from him, and we should be brave in telling other children and adults about his son, our Saviour. Yeah, you can hold it. No, you can hold it. It also reminds us from the book of Samuel about David, who was just a little shepherd boy who took on the big 9 foot tall, I believe, Goliath, who was carrying a spear and wearing armor. David put his trust in God, and it proved God's power and strength over all the enemies. The tiny little mouse in the story was pretty powerful. In fact, I think he was pretty awesome. Do you know what awesome? Do awesome, Rosie? Awesome. And our God is pretty awesome, isn't he? So how do we put our trust in God? We should read our Bibles, pray, praise God together as we're doing this morning, look after our neighbours, whether it be from East Kilbride or all over the world. In Joshua chapter 9, verse 1, it says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." So for those who answered my question this morning, I'm going to let the children see the book. Do you want to hold it up, boys? Rory? Let the adults see it, because some of the adults might not have read it. James? There you are. For all those who answered a question this morning, you can get a sticker. If you didn't answer the question, I might give you a sticker. There you go. This says, "Smile, God."
It's on my forehead.
"Smile, God loves you." There you go.
Perfect.
Yours says, "Smile, God loves you." Thank you. There?
No.
Oh. Adult stickers will be given later. Thank you. Be the name of the Lord.
Just before Gemma gives our Bible readings today, I just have a little bit of introduction to the two readings. Just let the children go first. I know that when John asked me to do the service for you because you had a gap in your rota, he said that you'd been following the lectionary through Lent, and so I've chosen to choose the lectionary passages for today, which is the fifth Sunday in Lent, and it's often called Passion Sunday, the time when we think about the Passion of Christ, his commitment, and the cross. And we're doing that today, although for the main part we're going to use the Old Testament reading, which is where we'll read about Ezekiel's vision of the Valley of the Dry Bones. It's a very powerful and graphic vision of dry bones in the desert, something as dead can be. And the question is, can life come back in this most dead place? Not by any logical means. We're talking dry bones and long dead here. But the words of the prophecy bring hope to Israel, where all is lost and gone. God will speak and God will act and Israel will thrive again. The second lesson, our gospel lesson, we're going to read a very, very short section from a much, much longer passage in John 11, the story of Jesus and the raising of Lazarus. And you'll remember in the story, just to set the scene, how Jesus heard that his friend Lazarus was ill. And he didn't immediately go to see Lazarus. He waited a couple of days. He didn't travel straight away. He stayed where he was before he set off to Bethany, which is where Lazarus' home was. And his disciples even then weren't convinced it was safe for him to go back because the people there had wanted to stone him. But Jesus heads back and he gets to Lazarus' house, and he's too late, for Lazarus is dead and laid to rest. Jesus raises Lazarus from the tomb, from death to life, and he tells Lazarus' sisters, Martha and Mary, that he is the resurrection and the life, and they believe him. And then we pick up, just reading the few verses, where Jesus encounters the reality of Lazarus's death and sees the mourning of his friends, and Jesus weeps. And so here we encounter Jesus bearing the loss and the death, even as he asks that the tomb is opened, and even as he says that he himself is the resurrection and the life.
Ezekiel 37, 1 to 14. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out of the spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord said to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the Sovereign Lord says, Come, breath from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the Sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and open you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live. and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. And from John 11, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you have been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odour, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? Amen.
O Lord, you search me and you know me. Our next hymn. Today, our Bible lessons paint vivid pictures for us from the Old Testament, Ezekiel's vision of that desert valley of the dry bones, dry as dry can be, life as gone can be. And then John's account of Jesus' action and reaction when his friend Lazarus died, laid in the tomb for 4 days. Vivid pictures to tell a story. It's quite interesting. We didn't coordinate the children's talk and this talk today, but it's quite interesting that one of the books that Helen put up was a book that was read to me when I was in school. When I was at school, the teacher sometimes read a book to you. And that title, The Silver Sword, and I didn't know it was by Ian Sirali, just brought it all back, that sitting with your head on the table in school, that picture of the book cover. I haven't thought about that for years, and it just brought it right back, just there, that picture. And so I was wondering what pictures say to you. Maybe quite a few of you have photos in your living room, on the mantelpiece or on the wall, or by the side of your bed in the bedroom. Does anybody keep photos? Family, friends, loved ones, new members of the family, the Waynes, members of the family gone to glory. Yes, so we all do that. And they're there and part of the furniture, but they kind of speak to us, don't they? They tell us of people and times and places, just a little one. Sometimes, do you have places that you like to be? Places that speak of things. For some folk, it's maybe a walk somewhere. A forest walk, a mountain, if you're fit to go up the mountain. For me, it's the beach. I like the beach and the sea. And there's something in that movement and that sense of space that speaks peace to me. Is that the case for other people? I think we all have different things. So certain things are just maybe an outline in themselves, but they speak deeper things to us. Things that make us laugh or smile or maybe remember with love. Not all pictures or stories or associations are so comfortable, though. This is the fifth Sunday of Lent, and the time to think through Lent, we're thinking of Jesus' journey to the cross and all that he went through and all that he taught and brought to us. But this, as I mentioned earlier, is traditionally Passion Sunday, the time where we think about cost and loss and pain. And our readings, both in different ways, took us to those places where life has gone. From Ezekiel, the vision of the dried out bones, the long dead lying in the desert, deader than dead, that is, until the word of the Lord is spoken and the breath goes into them. With the word of the Lord spoken, life flows in this deadest of dead places. In John's gospel, Lazarus is in the tomb, his body released from this life, the ceremony's done, the pain of loss being borne and endured. And at the word of the Lord, the one who is the resurrection and the life, life from God is demonstrated in this deadest of dead places. And so the glory of the Lord is revealed. The dead places are not places any of us want to be. And yet they come to us in so many ways through life, do they not? We experience, all of us, the dry, the barren, the hard place, the place we think we'll never get out of, the place we want to never remember. Some work in places where work numbs the mind and is soul-destroying, where there's no joy, where the day must be filled with the task that is paid for, where there are demands and demands, and the day becomes a drudge, a dry desert, a necessary, unfulfilling experience. Some endure relationships that take and take with little give, where energy is poured out for the other or others, and not much comes back, and where nothing lightens the day because it looks like love is no more. Some endure grievous loss. The landscape of life shifts in a moment, and all that was of love and life is gone, All that was of colour and hope is disappeared, and it looks like now is the day of the desert and of the barren place and of wondering if life can be lived again. We are people of Easter hope, but we journey to Easter hope through the barren places, the places of loss and dry bones. The journey of life takes us to places where, like Martha and Mary and Jesus and Lazarus's whole company of friends, we weep for that which is lost to us, for the life and hope and promise that is no more. And in those places, we can know that while we weep and mourn, that however deader than dead things look, that God is not finished. In Ezekiel, we hear, "Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, our hope is gone, we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says, my people. I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken. I have done it." Where God speaks, where the word of God is, where the Spirit moves, God works and life lives. And from John's Gospel, "Lord," says Martha, by this time there is a bad odor. He has been there 4 days. And Jesus says, "Did I not tell you, if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" Where human life is laid to rest, the one who is the resurrection and the life is present, bringing eternal life into the lost places. In the deadest of dead places, God is present, God is working. And even as we contemplate the dry bones, God is moving and acting. I had a conversation with a colleague a couple of weeks ago. Life isn't good for that colleague at the moment. On all sorts of levels, life is a struggle. And they were likening it to the Lenten journey, the journey in the desert. And then they said to me, and I've held this and I hold it now, they said, "God has a habit of turning up in the desert." And that's given me hope through the weeks since. There are times it's hard to hold this. We are people of the time that God gives to us. God is a God of all time. We see where we are here and now. We are people of the present. But God holds all time in his hand. We are overwhelmed by the troubles of the day and the losses we face. But God is a God of eternity, and God has a place and keeps us in the hope of what we do not yet see. Sometimes through the days of our lives, it can be difficult to hold hope. The world we live in has forces and powers far beyond our control. There are things that keep the rich rich and the poor poor, and we all know there are places where justice is not for everyone. There is war, there is violence, there are many things we do not choose and that we are not able to stop. The church, our church, the Church of Scotland, is in the midst of the most major change and reorganization that I've certainly ever known in my journey with the church. And for many, many people, it's very, very hard to see a shift in all that has been familiar to them, and many are experiencing loss and uncertainty and cannot quite see the new or the way ahead yet. God, our God, is the God who understands our experience through Christ. God recognizes our loss. God knows the desert experience. Jesus wept over Lazarus. It does not take loss away. Pain, the pain of lament, is not minimized. But in such loss is the light of hope, the promise that where the word of God speaks, there is life. The Spirit of God comes to the dry bones in the desert. The word is spoken and the glory of God is revealed. And so we live even with lament, even with pain, even with burden and even with struggle, as people promised the joy of Easter morning after the walk through the desert and the journey to the cross. Amen. May God bless to us these thoughts on his word. I brought now to gather your thoughts on the back of the reflection on God's word this morning, a video that Lewis is going to play for us now. It comes from Skit Guys. I don't know if you've had their stuff before. Very good. And it's 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. And it takes us through Jesus' life. And I think it brings us a message of hope. Thanks, tech team. And now we sing together to God's praise, Spirit of God.
Pray together. Loving Father, we thank you for this day you've given us and for the privilege of being able to come here and worship and praise you and hear your word. We thank you that through your goodness to us, we are able to bring these gifts of money here today and those given at other times and other ways as a token of thanks for all you have given to us. We are truly blessed. Lord, we pray for so many who are less fortunate than us, those who find themselves in dire situations through no fault of their own, who feel there is no hope of change. Help us through our offerings, prayers and actions to let those who are suffering know there is hope,
that Jesus can bring hope and light and love and joy into their lives. We pray for those countries where just speaking the name of Jesus can lead to punishment and even death. We pray for change in those countries. We continue to pray for those caught up in war in many places, including Ukraine, and we pray for peace in those countries. We pray for our mission partner, Gary Brough, and his family and the community they serve as they emerge from the devastating floods in Malawi. We pray for aid to reach them and help to rebuild their lives. We pray for positive, productive results in dealing with climate change, which is causing so much havoc throughout the world. We pray especially today for those affected by the tornadoes in the southern states of America. Father, we pray for wisdom, integrity, honesty, and compassion, both in our world leaders and in the leaders of this country. We pray especially for Scotland as we await the outcome of the leadership campaign and the identity of the new First Minister. We pray for unity in leading our country and for an end to the constant bickering between the differing political parties and even between the candidates for leadership in the same party. Gracious Father, we pray for our churches here in East Kilbride and elsewhere, and for the changes we face. Help us to face them together, helping and supporting each other wherever we can, putting our trust in the plan you have for us. We thank you for the blessings you have poured on us here in Claremont, especially in this period of vacancy. We continue to thank you for all who bring us your word each week. We thank you particularly today for Sandra and ask that you will bless her in everything she does in your name. And we thank you too for Anna and Alison, who through their signing being live streamed can reach so many who would otherwise be excluded. Father, help us to be mindful of the words we use when speaking to others. We may not always remember the things we say to others, but our words can have long-lasting effect on them. In the past few days, we have heard how one word not only crushed out the life of a committed, dedicated teacher, Ruth Perry, but also devastated the lives of her children, her elderly parents, her siblings, family and friends, her pupils and ex-pupils, her colleagues and ex-colleagues. The whole community of Caversham near Reading, where she grew up, lived and worked. Lord, we bring all these people before you now and place them in your loving care. Ruth wrote in her primary pupils' yearbooks as they moved on to high school, "Remember always to be kind." A fitting legacy she has left behind and a poignant message for us all. Lord, you have told us, if your people who are called by your name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from their wicked ways, then you will hear from heaven and you will forgive their sins and will heal their land. Heavenly Father, we humble ourselves before you now and ask you to hear our prayers in the precious name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. Should I go down and come back up before I start reading? In case you're wondering why I mentioned Ruth Perry, she was an ex-colleague, a former colleague and a close friend of my daughter Gillian, who is a teacher in Berkshire, as many of you know. So, our notice is, thanks first of all to Sandra for being here today and for leading us in worship. And she was talking about that passage from Ezekiel and photographs of our loved ones going to glory. And that passage always reminds me of my father-in-law, who has been gone for some time now, but I was going to say his party piece, but one of his many party pieces was the song Dem Bones, Dem Bones, Dem Dry Bones. And you're going to be singing it all day now, I know you will. Anyway, so this past week, the notice is this week. This past week, a wee brief thing on mission planning. All three kit sessions this week agreed to accept the pro forma questionnaire that we've been working on for a wee while. We all had session meetings, South Parish on Monday, Claremont on Tuesday, and Washington Wednesday. Extracts of these, in the minutes of those meetings where we accepted it, have gone off to Presbytery, and as will the pro forma, and we will just wait to hear what happens now. Once Presbytery has responded, we will hopefully post the pro forma on the website for everyone to see, and there will be a few hard copies. We haven't done it yet in case they come back to us and say, maybe Sandra can tell you more about this than I can, in case they come back to us and say they want changes or something like that, but it will eventually. I mean, it is there, you can ask for it now if you want, but there could be changes made, we don't know. Yesterday's coffee morning with the brownies raised £317, and thanks goes to everyone who came along and supported them in any way. Next Saturday will be the turn of the ladies' circle, that's always a good one. And there will be, you can pay at the door if you don't have a ticket, there will be home baking, there will be jewellery. I always seem to buy earrings for some reason. Buy earrings. Jewellery, handbags, home baking, all sorts of things going on. Rolls and sausage, that's the other one, the most important one. So that's Saturday coming. The Holy Week services, now I've got loads of bits of paper here. I upgraded to a folder, and now my folder's full of bits of paper. Yes, the Holy Week services. Now, outside on the vestibule, there are some things that look like this and this, and they're all lying together. If you remember, the Thursday night service is going to be at Mosnewk, and it's earlier, it's at 6 o'clock, and it is a Passover meal, a sort of authentic Passover meal. Now, there is a list of some things out there which, if you feel you want to take a contribution of food or drink with you, there are some suggestions there. Can I just say, they don't want hot food, they don't want anything you've made at home and then it has to go there and be reheated, or anything that needs to be cooked in the premises. They're dealing with that. Anything that you, if you, you don't, there's no compulsion to take anything, you don't have to take anything, you're welcome to just to go. But if you wanted to contribute anything, they would like it to be cold food that's ready cooked and shop bought and still in its original packaging, because we want to enjoy our time together with Mosnewk and South Parish. We don't want to give them food poisoning. So if you can, if there's, to say the farm's out there, there's also a list if you want to, if you're thinking of going to the meal, if you want to put your name down, there's a list out there for that. Now, there's the next bit that I nearly lost. Right, so that's the Holy Week services. After the service today is the congregational prayer meeting, that's at 12 o'clock. So grab your cup of tea, and it would be nice to see as many of you there as possible. And a reminder that this Tuesday is the stated annual meeting, which is open to everyone. And I see someone making a face, not allowed to do that. everyone's welcome. If you want to know how things work sort of behind the scenes and what have you, please come. And a reminder also to elders that after the stated annual meeting, there will be a very, very brief 5-minute session meeting. And that is all the notices for today. And our last hymn is The Lord's My Shepherd.
Thank you.
So we bless one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.